No. More about alcoholism. This is more about alcoholism, focuses primarily on step one. You know that the chapter, the next chapter, chapter four, We Agnostics, is essentially dedicated to step two. You know, do you believe in God, yes or no? And more about alcoholism is, there's a lot in here about mostly step one, but then there's the area where you transition that we have, where he's talking about the insanity of the jaywalker who keeps skipping out in front of moving trolleys, trolley cars for the high and all that, and the idea that he's trying to get across is the insanity of that precedes the first drink, not the insanity that's a result of years of drinking, which I know is a really big misconception in AA today. And you know, how many times have I been in a meeting where I hear somebody say, my life's getting insane again? And I say, well, then you just completely missed the idea behind insanity in the second step, that God will restore us to sanity. All he's going to restore you to is your reaction to the first drink. It's the insanity that precedes the first drink that we're looking to be restored with. But anyway, that's the second half of this, more about alcoholism. And we got this, there's really a real good description of, you know, here in the middle of the page here on chapter 3, page 30. So I'm an alcoholic. My name's Doug. And this is chapter 3, more about alcoholism. And yeah, that thing's got a noisy gearbox, doesn't it? The gearbox is in there whining away and moving things. And okay, most of us have been unwilling to admit we were real alcoholics. No person likes to think he is bodily and mentally different from his fellows. Therefore, it is not surprising that our drinking careers have been characterized by countless vain attempts to prove we could drink like other people. The idea that somehow someday he will control and enjoy his drinking is the great obsession of every abnormal drinker. The persistence of this illusion is astonishing. Many pursue it into the gates of insanity or death. Now, that's pretty clear right there. The persistence of this illusion is astonishing. The great obsession of every abnormal drinker that someday he will control and enjoy his drinking. The only thing I can think of is that there was a period in my life when it was fun, and I did control it to a point that it was, you know, most people said, you know, hey, he's, you know, going out and partying, but he's doing the normal things that normal people do, until it got to the point that the normal things that normal people do just didn't exist anymore, and all I was trying to do was recapture the good old days, as I call it. I wanted to go back to the good old days when I could drink again. And I don't know, man. That's one of my unanswered questions in AA. Was why? How come there was a point in my life when I reached it and I said, "That's it. I just don't want to do it anymore." And on page 30, more about alcoholism. It's the thing everybody reads in the beginning. You know, most of us have been unwilling to admit we were blah blah. We're like men who've lost their legs and all that. I always get uncomfortable with that. I was at a meeting at the Boca Pines, and there was a guy with one leg. And every time they'd hand it to me, I'd be like, "I'm not reading that." He's like a kind of a buddy of mine. I, you know, talk to him all the time. He's got one leg. What am I gonna? We're like this guy who lost one leg. He'll never grow a new. That's kind of. All right. So now this is what I've learned is a very. It's really the first place in here where it says that this is the first step. You're working on the first step right here. And when he says we learned, we had to fully concede. He's talking about we. The first 100 that, you know, supposedly wrote the book. Of course, it was Bill that wrote the book, and there were several, probably 8 or 10 people of the most sober people who had the most time, like Dr. Bob, and who you know, gave him a little input on what to do. You know, should they change this? And the whole God as we understand him thing came out. So, of course, this is, you know, like in the chapter when Bill writes the chapter to wives. He's actually writing it as if there was a wife giving comments and a wife telling you what was going on, but it's Bill Wilson writing it. And it's his wife who's giving him a little, you know, here, write this, write that. So you might say he's like the ghost writer, but here he's also, he's the ghost writer for all the first 100 people who were sober at the time. And whenever you see we learned we had to fully concede, it goes back to the idea that there's a lot of the rehab and halfway house stuff creeping into our AA today, and And the, what's wrong with that is that people give the illusion that you can have a support group of people that you can call on and that somehow that will suffice to be your sobriety. And what that does is it takes away from the idea that you got to be, it's, this is between you and God, and that's what this is. And anything that other people have to do with this is what you can do for those other people. So not, you know, not so much what you can call and lean on them. You need to be calling on God, and that's... Whenever you're not calling on God and you're calling on other people, you can easily see how that that's taken away from the original idea of the program, that we're looking to build a relationship between us and God. And any time you put some kind of interference in there of calling on human solutions, then we sit around and wonder why nobody's making it, you know. But that's what I was getting at, was the we learned we had to fully concede to our innermost selves. And so many people I hear come in here with a misconception of that, going, you know, this is a we program, together we. No, this is a you and God program. You better find God or you ain't going to make it. We learned we had to fully concede. Now, this is what we, the first 100, did when we got sober and stayed sober and never took another drink. We learned that we had to fully concede. That's a very deep statement there. Fully concede to our innermost self. Fully concede. There's no way to wiggle out of that. You know, partially concede to, you know, a part of ourselves, to our innermost selves, that we were alcoholics. This is the first step in recovery. The delusion that we are like other people, or presently maybe, has to be smashed, and there's only one way to smash that, and that's trial and error. But the question that I have is, how come so many people spend decades longer than I did with the trial and error part? I mean, I got to tell you, when I was done, and that's all there was to it. I didn't want to do anything anymore, much less drink or. But you know, I see people out there just keeping, they just keep going at it and going at it. We alcoholics are men and women who have lost the ability to control our drinking. We know that no real alcoholic ever recovers that control. All of us felt at times that we were regaining control, but such intervals, usually brief, were inevitably followed by still less control, which led in time to pitiful and incomprehensible demoralization. That's a term that I hear a lot in here, people trying to remember what it says, the whole pitiful and incomprehensible. We are convinced to a man that alcoholics of our type are in the grip of a progressive illness. Over any considerable period, we get worse, never better. Now, that's a pretty flat-out statement there, too. I mean, how many people think that that their alcoholism is going to stay steady and they're going to be able to maintain where they're at right now? If you're a real alcoholic, alcoholics of our type are in the grip of a progressive illness that gets worse and worse and worse as time goes on. Over any considerable period, we get worse, never better. It doesn't maintain the same. It gets worse. For me, my fear was that my health was going to get worse. You know, that's one of the things that always, it still scares me today. That's what keeps me eating, like, bananas and oranges and vegetables and stuff like that. You're living in a lump of meat, you know. I always thought my health was going to get worse and worse, and I was going to end up looking like those guys that I was hanging with. Looked like they had one foot on a banana peel and the other foot in a grave, you know. I got sober when I was 26, and I looked a lot younger and healthier than I do now, but that scared the hell out of me. We are like men and women who've lost their legs. Oh, wait a minute, it doesn't say women. We are like men who have lost their legs. They never grow new ones. Neither does there appear to be any kind of treatment which will make alcoholics of our kind like other men. We have tried every imaginable remedy. In some instances, there has been brief recovery, followed always by a still worse relapse. Physicians who are familiar with alcoholism agree that there is no such thing as making a normal drinker out of an alcoholic. Science may one day accomplish this, but it hasn't done so yet. Where he says, we have tried every imaginable remedy. In some instances, there has been brief recovery, followed always by a still worse relapse. Back in Bill's story, there's a spot where he's in step one. See, what we're talking about here now is step one. You know, the first step. This is the first step in recovery. And when you go back to Bill's story, Bill's got a pretty good description of step one in there, where he says, no words. Now, this is page 8 in Bill's story. And he goes on to explain here that there was something that kept him sober for a brief period of time, and that was my experience with it, too. I had this experience for a couple of years in my life. No words can tell of the loneliness and despair. This is page 8 in Bill's story. No words, this is like step one for Bill. Despair that I found in that bitter morass of self-pity. Quicksand stretched around me in all directions. I had met my match. I had been overwhelmed, alcohol was my master. Trembling, I stepped from the hospital a broken man, and fear sobered me for a bit. Then came the insidious insanity of that first drink, and on Armistice Day I was off again. Armistice Day 1934, I was off again.